The United States Supreme Court did something good today. Not only did they do something good today, they unanimously supported a worker and workers' rights today. Yes, that Supreme Court that leans conservative with not one, not two, but three Supreme Court justices that were nominated by Donald Trump. So with that said, let's get into the details. The Supreme Court unanimously revived a sex discrimination lawsuit. That's what this is about, okay? And it was filed by a police officer in St. Louis after she was forcibly transferred to an undesirable new role. Now, she's alleging that discrimination played a role in this employment transfer. She wants to move forward with this case, with this lawsuit. But the constitutionality of said lawsuit was called into question, which is why the Supreme Court was able to weigh in on this. Now, Sergeant Jatonia Muldrow had worked for 9 years in a plainclothes position in the department's intelligence division before a new commander reassigned her to a uniformed position in which she supervised patrol officers. The new commander wanted a male officer in the intelligence job and sometimes called her Mrs. instead of Sergeant. Now, Muldrow said in court filings, according to ABC News, that her assignment lacked the same prestige and benefits. Even though her pay remained the same, she lost her FBI privileges, had to work patrol, and was assigned weekend shifts. Muldrow, who according to the court filings was known as a workhorse, was replaced in the intelligence division by a male sergeant who previously worked with Muldrow's male supervisor. Okay, so she decides to use Title VII of the Civil Rights Act of 1964 to bring forth a suit. And that basically prohibits workplace discrimination based on sex, race, religion, and national origin. Okay, so Title VII also requires employees to prove that discrimination caused them significant harm, such as a pay cut, demotion, or job loss. However, two of the lower courts had dismissed her claim, concluding that she had not suffered a significant job disadvantage. So this works its way up the courts, the court system. And after it was brought to the Supreme Court, the justices had to decide whether this statute that she was using guards against all discriminatory job transfers. Now, let's pause for a second, John. Would you, prior to this ruling, believe for a second that unanimously the Supreme Court would side with her? I wouldn't. I'd be like, there's no way they're gonna side with her.
Yeah, I mean, it's talking about whether this particular statute, if job transfers can be encapsulated under something that is considered sort of a demotion or something that can be seen as objectively discriminatory. I don't know. No, I don't expect anything. That's the short answer. I don't expect anything to be unanimous. I wouldn't say that there's, if you had just told me how did they rule on this, I wouldn't say they definitely ruled against it. It seems somewhat minor. And we look,
it's
we
not
have
minor.
Over the past couple
I totally disagree.
An extension of this I don't know. I mean, but the point I was going to make was that we have given the Supreme Court credit several times over the past few years when they have done not necessarily that which we would have expected them
right.
to. So I don't 100% expect them in all cases to be insane. Why do you consider this particular thing to be so surprising?
It has to do with workers' rights. Mm-hmm. It has to do with something that we typically would assume that conservative Supreme Court justices who were handpicked by the Federalist Society would basically rule against, right? Mm-hmm. And look, the Federalist Society handpicks certain judges because of their pro-corporate stance.
Pausing here to deliver some honest truth as we do in our news coverage as well. TYT is facing challenges, guys, as the entire industry is. You know who could make the difference? You. If you hit the join button below, it's gonna make all the difference and keep us in business. We appreciate you, thank you.
Because of the fact that they like things like money in politics, they like deregulation, they typically side with corporations or employers over their workers. But look, the reason why I'm pointing to this is, number one, I don't agree that this is a small thing. This sets precedent, which allows for other employees in other workplaces who might have been you know, victimized by discriminatory transfers to pursue legal action against their employer, right? It says that this incredibly important statute also applies to them, so they can take legal action. It's not just about this one particular worker, it's about the precedent it sets and how it allows for other workers to have the statute as a form of protection against unfair workplace practices.
Yeah, when I say minor, I don't mean that it's a small thing for the people for whom it affects. Obviously for her it was significant. She's been willing to go through all this legal trouble because her life was, you know, like tossed into chaos as a result of this. What I mean more is, it doesn't seem to me objectively, and I don't have the numbers, I don't know how many people suffer these sorts of, you know, transfers, forcible transfers that are considered demotions. It doesn't seem to me to be like a systemic threat to employers.
Oh,
no,
John.
It's not like establishing a new minimum wage, or it seems like it's affecting a far smaller number.
John, you got to get out of this like brain dead mindset that like if it's not a widespread issue, then it doesn't matter as much. Like you got to get out of it. I don't know how many of the.
That's not what I'm saying.
No, but you say it's not that big of a deal because we don't know how many people are dealing with discriminatory transfers. I don't care if it's a group of five people in the entire country who face it.
I apologize if I'm miscommunicating.
This sets a precedent moving forward that workers can take advantage of.
No. What I'm saying is the Supreme Court is not always going to say, does this 1% hurt employers? Well, then obviously I'm going to shoot it down. There's a transactional nature to it in that they make multiple decisions every year, let alone over a few years. They're not going to make all of them in a way that makes them clearly seem corrupt. So theoretically, you can buy a little bit of cover by doing things like this that don't provide a sort of systemic threat to employers. And then you can do the more radical stuff and it's sort of a mixed bag. That's what I'm saying. When I say that it's not a big thing, I'm not saying anything about the effect that it has on people's lives. I'm saying it's not a thing that is, I wouldn't imagine from the point of view of employers to be make or break for them.
Okay, so your take is, this is what the conservative Supreme Court justices are willing to do in favor of workers to provide cover for other rulings that are far more detrimental.
I'm not saying that that's necessarily what they do. They do that in many cases. I mean, there's even people talking about the possibility of them doing that with things like presidential immunity versus the ballot access case. You rule on one and theoretically you provide some ideological cover for the other. I'm not even saying in this case it is that, but I guess, okay, well then I would turn it on you. If you consider this to be them really, I guess, turning against employers, well then why do you believe that they've done that?
First of all, I didn't say that. And the reason why I'm covering this story in the first place is because we have an idea in our heads and we have certain expectations of various institutions based on who is in those institutions, right? And I think oftentimes when we have like, when we're dead set on those assumptions, it could lead us astray. And honestly, I don't know how they come to these conclusions, right? I don't know what's really motivating them. Sure, you can be super cynical and just assume that they're doing this in order to provide cover for other rulings that are far more favorable to employers and corporations. But there have been more and more examples that have been surprising to me about the Supreme Court. And so I think it's important to be realistic about what's happening with these Supreme Court rulings, how mixed they really are, in order to prevent ourselves from being complete and utter doomers about everything that's happening
in
government.
Okay, then in that case, I think you misunderstood what I was saying.
Okay.
When I said that I wasn't super surprised by this, it's because I don't come into this with the expectation that literally anything that helps workers even 1%, they're automatically gonna shoot down. And that's why I cited that we have gone out of our way to give them credit for decisions that weren't necessarily what we'd expected.
True.
I'm at that position that you're describing already. That's why I'm not shocked by it.
Okay, that's good. That's good. Okay, so let's go to what the justices wrote in their opinion. So Justice Elena Kagan wrote for the court saying that today we disprove the approach or that approach, meaning the approach of essentially preventing workers from being able to use this statute as it pertains to workplace transfers. Although an employee must show some harm from a forced transfer to prevail in a Title VII suit, she need not show that the injury satisfies a significance test. Title VII's text nowhere establishes that high bar. Muldrow need show only some injury. Respecting her employment terms or conditions, the transfer must have left her worse off, but not have left her significantly so, which I totally agree with, especially if the employee, you know, in this case, Muldrow, is able to show that what motivated the transfers, because she has to prove it. She can't just say that it happened. Obviously, she has to prove it. The court is now allowing her to move forward with this case. That's what this was. But she would still have to prove that the intent was discriminatory, right? So many bias lawsuits have had a split reaction among US appeals courts, but according to the Justice Department brief to the court, discriminatory transfers always violate the law. They necessarily involve a change in working conditions. Today's ruling will have a huge effect on many cases going forward, allowing lawsuits that had failed under the old standard to presumably succeed. Justice Kagan pointed to cases in which people lost discrimination suits, including those of an engineer whose new job site was a 14 by 22 foot wind tunnel. What? A shipping worker reassigned to exclusively nighttime work, and a school principal who was forced into a new administrative role that was not based in a school. Kagan continued saying that Muldrow's allegations now meet the court's new standard with room to spare. If those allegations are proved, she was left worse off several times over. It does not matter, as the courts below thought, that her rank and pay remain the same, or that she still could advance to other jobs. So look, overall, I think this is a good ruling by the Supreme Court. I think it's important to know about the positive rulings in addition to the negative rulings, or the rulings we don't agree with and talk about on this show as well. Overall, anything that provides some additional protection to workers, any statute that can be interpreted in a way that expands it to protect more workers is a good thing. And I'm really happy that this was a unanimous decision by the United States Supreme Court, which again, overwhelmingly leans in the conservative direction.
If you enjoyed this video, that's because of our members. They make us independent, they make us strong, and they make us honest. Become a member today by hitting the join button below.